Good morning, dear students. Today we are here to go move on the contract 2 syllabus further. That is, earlier in the classes we have completed till unit 3 in conditions and warranties, wherein we were left with just to complete the implied warranties. So let's begin with implied warranties, and then we will move on to rule of caveat emptor, which is the last topic of unit 3. Now, when we talk about implied warranties, before that, let's try to know that what is warranties, which I have already discussed in the lectures in the classes. Now, warranty simply means a stipulation wherein it is need to be collateral to the main purpose of the contract. And the second point, if there is a breach of anything, then the aggrieved party would have a right to claim the damages, but he cannot terminate or cancel the contract, which means it is a stipulation which is contrary to the main contract. Let's take an example for this. For example, SX went to a shop to buy a car. So he asked the dealer to let him know which car he can buy of a good quality. So the dealer gave him a particular car and said that this car could run over 20 kilometers per petrol. X bought that car, but that car was just able to give 15 kilometers per petrol. So in this statement, or in this case, the seller has given a warranty to Mr. X. Therefore, he was not entitled to reject the car, but he can claim damages. Why? Because the warranty which was given, that it can run up to 20 kilometers per petrol, but it was not able to run. So this particular warranty was stipulation, that is, it was collateral to the main contract, and the main contract was buying of the car. So these are implied, these are the point of what does warranty means. Now let's move on to kinds of implied warranties. Before that, we'll discuss what is implied warranties. When we talk about implied warranties, these are the warranties which are not present into the contract, but they can be applied through the operation of law, trade, or custom, which means they are not within the contract in which I am entering, but I can apply that warranty through the operation of law, trade, or custom. This is termed as implied warranties. Now, there are certain kinds of implied warranties which we will now discuss. These are around four to five kinds of implied warranties. Now, let's start discussing. Number one is implied warranty for quiet possession, which is present under Section 14, Clause B of the Sale of Goods Act. Now, which says that where the buyer has obtained a possession of the goods, and if the buyer is in any way disturbed in the enjoyments of the good, then the buyer has a right to sue the seller for the damages. Which simply means if buyer has got the possession of the goods and he is disturbed while enjoying the possession of the goods, then the buyer has a right to claim damages from the seller. Let's take an example. Mr. X went to buy a second-hand radio. So when he bought the second-hand radio from Y, he spent around rupees 100 for repairing the radio and everything. Further, the radio was seized by the police on the point that it was stolen one. So now when Y filed a suit against X for recovery for the breach of warranty of quiet possession, including the cost of repairs, it was held that Y is liable. Why? Because once X has sold the radio to the Y, which means that Y has now obtained the possession, but his possession was disturbed. He was disturbed with enjoyment of the possession, and that quiet possession made the seller liable because the seller did not inform Y that it is a stolen one. Now, this is the first kind, that is implied warranty for quiet possession. Now we'll move to the second type, that is implied warranty against encumbrance. Now this means that there is an implied warranty in all cases of sale that the goods are not subject to any charge in favor of third parties, which is not disclosed or known to the buyer before or at any time when the contract is made, which means that it is simply an implied warranty in which within the contract of sale of goods, There is no subject of any charge to the third parties, nor any matter is disclosed to the buyer or known to the buyer at any time the contract is made. This very provision is present under Section 14, Clause C of the Sales of Goods Act. Let's take an example. X borrowed rupees 500 from Y, okay? And he gave his radio as a security for that rupees 500. Later on, X went and sold that radio to Mr. Z, which means Mr. Z has bought that radio in the good faith. He was not knowing that X has given that radio as a security to Y. Now here Z can claim damages because his possession is disturbed. Why? Because Y is having a charge. So that is why it is said implied warranty against any encumbrance, which means there should not be any charge to the third party or any disclosing of the matter. If so it happened, then the seller would be liable. Let's move on to the another type of implied warranty. That is implied warranty as to usage of trade, which is present under Section 16, Clause 3 of the Sales of Goods Act. Now, an implied warranty has to quality or fitness for a particular purpose may be fixed by the usage of time, which means whatever product or the goods I am buying, that should be fixed with the quality and fitness of the particular purpose which I want to attain. For example, I want to buy a car. So the quality and the fitness of the cars, which should be so much fixed with my particular purpose. And why I want to buy the car? I want to buy the car to use it for car racing. So it should be, the fitness or the quality of it should be in accordance with the purpose which I want to achieve. If the seller fails to do so, then he would be liable. Next is implied warranty to disclose dangerous nature of the goods. In the case of goods of dangerous nature, the seller must disclose or warn the buyer that there can be a probability of the danger when you are using this good. If seller failed to do so, buyer would be liable under breach of implied warranties, which means that if whenever I'm, suppose for example, I'm buying a particular product which might be dangerous in nature or it might contain some dangerous activity, so that the seller need to inform me that I need to use it in this way. If I fail to do so, I may suffer danger or I may suffer loss. Due to if the seller fails to do so, then he would be liable for the breach of warranty. Let's take a case law to understand the point much better. That is in Clark versus Army and Navy Cooperative Society Limited. In this, what happened? A person X went and purchased certain disinfective powder, which he wanted to use it for his home, to cleaning of his house. Now, it was needed that this powder need to be opened with special kind of a cone or special kind of a product. Otherwise, it would cause some danger. So, Mr. X's wife opened the powder without any special cone and she got injured over the eyes because that powder flew into its eye and her eyes got infected. Now, the seller has not informed this to Mr. X. So seller would be liable for the injury which the Mr. X wife has suffered as because of breach of warranty. So the point is clear that certain kinds of warranties which are not present within the contract but can be applied through the operation of law, through trade or custom, then these warranties are termed as implied warranties, and the breach of these implied warranties will make the party to pay compensation or damages to the aggrieved party. Herein, aggrieved party can only claim the damages but cannot repudiate or cancel the contract. So with this, we have completed the topic, that is implied warranties. Now we'll move on to the another topic and the last topic of our module 3, that is rule of caveat emptor. Now, as already we have discussed in the class, and I think most of you already know that the meaning of caveat emptor is simply let the buyer be aware, which simply means that if I have went into a market to purchase a shampoo of a particular brand, I must be very much aware that whatever product I am buying, that is to the quality, that need to fit my hair, and my skill and judgments over that product must be capable enough to decide that I want to buy this product. This is simply the rule of or doctrine of caveat emptor, that the buyer need to be aware. Now let's discuss what does the meaning of rule of caveat emptor means? The rule of caveat emptor is an integral part of Sale of Goods Act 1930, which means it is an important part within the Sale of Goods Act of 1930. Now, which simply means let the buyer be aware, which means it is a responsibility of the buyer to choose among themselves what kind of a product he is buying, he or she, to check the quality of the product, the suitability of the product. Herein, buyer also bears a responsibility that if whatever product he or she wants to buy must provide the information to the seller that I need this product as per my requirements. And then the seller has the duty to give the product to the buyer in accordance with that requirements which the buyer needs. And it is the skill and judgment of the buyer to decide that whether this product matches quality of the requirements or not. So thus the rule of caveat emptor applies in the cases of purchase of special goods where buyer can use his own skill and judgment to buy the goods. For example, if I want to buy a book. Suppose I want to buy a book of, say, Feli S. Nerman. So I must be aware that this is the author and the book I want to buy is this. It should fit to the quality and to the suitability of my requirement, whatever I want to buy the good, which means I must be capable enough to judge that this particular book is suitable for me for the reading. Next. Now, where does rule of caveat emptor is present under the Sale of Goods Act? It is present under section 16 of the Sale of Goods Act, which states that subject to the provisions of this act and any another law for the time being in force, there is no implied warranty or condition as to quality or fitness for any particular purpose of goods supplied under the contract of sale, which means that the buyer has to be aware in whatever quality or fitness of the good he or she is buying. There is no any time being in force, no implied warranty or condition applied to it, which means the buyer should be skilled enough to decide that whatever product he or she is buying, it is suitable to his requirements of the goods. Now let's move on to the case laws which laid down the foundation of this rule of caveat emptor. We'll discuss two case laws. Number one is Ward versus Hopes. Now this case law was decided by the House of the Lords. In this, the House of the Lords held that if a seller uses his artifice or disguise to conceal the defects in the product which is to be sold, then it amounts to the fraud. Which means that suppose a person X has went to buy a particular product and he has explained the seller that he needs the product as per this requirement. In that, if seller artifice or disguises conceal the facts, then that amounts to a fraud. Still, no duty to disclose the defects in the product is imposed on the seller under the rule of caveat emptor. An obligation to use proper care, skill while purchasing the goods is under the hands of the buyer within the rule of caveat emptor. So House of Lords in this case law said that rule of caveat emptor simply means the buyer has an obligation to use his care, diligence, and skill to decide in whatever product he is buying. The seller do not bear any such responsibility to inform him regarding that this particular product has a defect. Take for example, I have went to buy a particular medicine in the shop. I asked the shopkeeper that I want this particular medicine, say paracetamol. Now, when I bought the medicine, it is my responsibility to check that what is the date of manufacturing of the medicine, what is the date of expiring of the medicine. It might be possible that the seller might have given me an expiry date medicine. So it is the responsibility to decide to the care and the skill of the judgment as per my requirement of the goods that I am buying is upon me. In this case, the seller would not be responsible under the rule of caveat emptor. Now, the next case law that we will discuss is Wallace versus Russell. This case law was decided by the Court of Appeal, wherein the court explained the scope of caveat emptor and said that the rule of caveat emptor implies that the buyer must take care, which simply means the buyer in accordance with the requirements of the good, must use his care, skill, and diligence to decide that this particular product which he or she is buying is getting suitable to its requirement. Which I've already told you also that, for example, of buying of a book, a buying of a picture. It also implies in the cases where by usage or term of contract, it is implied that the buyer should not rely on the skill and judgment of the seller. Suppose I went to buy a particular dress to the mall. Now, it is upon my skill and judgment, I should not rely upon the seller that I wanted to buy a jeans. And the seller told me that the particular size would fit you. But it is my skill and the judgment to decide that this particular size which was said by the seller would not fit me, but this particular another size would fit me. So there, in terms of the contract, in the usage of the contract, there is implied that I should not rely on the skill and the judgment of the seller. I should rely on my care, skill, and the judgment to decide whether the product which I am buying is suitable to my particular purpose or not, suitable to my requirements or not. So this is the rule of caveat emptor, which means the buyer bears a responsibility. He need to be aware in whatever products he or she is buying. In that case, seller would not be responsible. The point is that the buyer need to inform the seller that I want these particular products. This is my requirements of the products. And he need to give proper information. Based on that information, the seller will produce him the products or show him the products. Now, whether to decide that this particular product A or B suit into my capability or not, that need to be decided by the buyer. This is the rule of the caveat emptor. Now, there are certain exceptions to the rule of the caveat emptor. We will move on with the discussion of those certain exceptions. Number one is fitness for the buyer's purpose. Now, this is present under article, section 16, clause 1 of the Sales of Goods Act. Section 16, clause 1 of the Sales of Goods Act states that where the seller or manufacturer is a dealer or the type of goods sold by him, the buyer has disclosed the purpose for which goods are required and relied upon the seller's description or the skill or the judgment, which means that when the seller is aware that either by expressively or impliedly, it has been expressed and impliedly by the buyer, he has informed that he wants the particular product as per the requirement, and if as per the requirement of the skill and judgment, in such case, doctrine of caveat emptor will not be into function. Which simply means that the buyer has either expressively or impliedly has made the seller known that he wants the particular product according to this specific purpose, according to this description, which should suit his requirements. In such case, if the seller fails to do so, the buyer would not be responsible and the seller would be responsible and the rule of caveat emptor would not take into picture. Let's understand the point better with the help of a case law. In the case of Sheetal Kumar Shaini versus Sadhvir Singh, a compressor was purchased by the petitioner within 1 year warranty, which means he purchased a compressor in which 1 year warranty was there, wherein he has informed the seller about that he wanted to purchase a compressor which all these requirements. Now, the compressor has certain kind of a defect that within 3 months it was not working properly. So now petitioner went for a replacement. The seller replaced the compressor but did not give any further warranty. So the state commission stated that an implied warranty was guaranteed under section 16 of Sale of Goods Act and it is allowed to be rejected. Which simply means that as the contract itself says that when you went to buy the compressor, 1 year warranty was there. So if any replacement is done, he need to get further warranty within 3 months if the replacement, further warranty that from today onwards, I am buying the product, I'm replacing the product. So till that extent, the warranty would be given. So that depends. This is the point of fitness for the buyer's purpose. Under section 16, it clearly specifies that when the buyer has expressively or impliedly make the seller known that he want to buy this particular product according to the requirements, and must suitable for the buyer's purpose. In such case, the doctrine of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Let's move on to the second exception. That is sale under patent or trade name. Now, this is present under the section of same 16 clause 1, but it is a provision of the section 16 clause 1. In this case of contract, it says that contract for sale by a specified article which has a patent or a trade name, there is an implied condition that the goods shall be reasonably fit for any particular purpose. So here the doctrine of caveat emptor would not take into the picture, which means any such contract of sale in which goods have been specified under a particular patent or a trade name, then it is an implied condition that the good is in accordance to the quality of the fitness. And in this case, the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Next exception is present under section 16 clause 2, which states mercantile quality, which says that where the goods are purchased by description from a seller who deals in goods of such description, there is an implied consideration that the goods shall be of mercantile quality, which means simply that when the goods are bought by a particular description from the seller who deals in that goods of that description, whether he's a manufacturer or a producer, there is an implied condition that goods are of mercantile quality, which simply means that when a person X has went to buy a particular product from a same manufacturer Y, and he is very much, the seller manufacturer Y is very much aware of the description, and he described the goods to the seller X of proper, that what is the goods, how, what can be the causes if you are using it goods, what can be the benefits that you will give to the goods. So if the buyer has examined the goods and then bought the goods, then the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Next exception is conditions implied by trade usage, which is present under section 16 clause 3 of the Sales of Goods Act. An implied warranty or condition as to quality or fitness for a particular purpose may be annexed by the usage of trade, which means that if by the usage of trade an implied condition and warranty is there to the quality of the fitness of the product, then in that case the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Let's understand it with the case law. In the case law of Peter Darlington Partners Limited versus Gosho Company Limited, a contract for sale of canary seeds was subjected to the custom of trade and held that if there exist any impurities in the seeds, the buyer will get a rebate on the price, but he would not reject the goods. However, a custom which is unreasonable will not affect the party's contract, which means that in this a contract of sale, there was a sale of canary seeds, which was subject to certain custom of trade, that if it consists of impurities or anything, the buyer will get the prices of that. So in that usage of the trade, the aspect of caveat emptor or rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Buyer who can claim for the damages, but he cannot reject the goods. However, if the custom is unreasonable, unlawful, then this particular aspect would not come into the picture. Now let's move on to the next exception, that is consent by fraud, where the consent of the buyer is obtained by the seller or where the seller conceals a defect, the doctrine of caveat emptor will not apply. Which means, suppose for example, where the buyer Mr. X has went to buy a product and the seller has defected a product and conceals certain defect or anything, so he has committed a fraud. In that case, rule of caveat emptor would not be applicable. This we have already also discussed in the earlier case law, which was decided by the House of the Lords. Next, if the buyer has given the consent with the way of fraud, which means seller has obtained the consent of the buyer by the way of the fraud, then also the rule of caveat emptor would not apply. Next, move on to the next exception, that is sale by sample. Now, where the goods are brought by the sample, the doctrine does not apply if the bulk does not correspond with the sample. But simply means sale by sample and sale by description, we have already discussed in the earlier classes. So when the goods are being sold on the basis of the sample, then the doctrine of caveat emptor would not apply if that does not correspond to the sample. Next exception is sale by description, and this is the last exception of the rule of caveat emptor, which says that where the goods are sold by description and the goods supplied by the seller do not correspond to the description, then also the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Sale by sample is present under section 16 of the Sales of Goods Act. Sale by description is present also under section 15 of the Sales of Goods Act. So simply means when a buyer is going to buy a particular product based upon the sample or the description given by the seller, so there the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Let's get it more clear with the case law. In the case of Priest versus Last, the plaintiff purchased a hot water bottle from the shop. That is, was a retail chemist's shop. After some days, the bottle was, while the plaintiff's wife was using the bottle got burst and the wife got injuries. So the plaintiff sued the defendant. It was held that if the description of the goods by which they were sold pointed out to one particular purpose, then the requirement of disclosure of the purpose is deemed to be fulfilled. Which means, as this was sale by description, the description within the bottle of the packet of the bottle was clearly given, so which fulfilled the condition of the requirement of disclosing all the facts. So herein the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. So these are the certain exceptions of the rule of caveat emptor. With this aspect, we are able to understand that now rule of caveat emptor simply means let the buyer be aware. So whenever a buyer it is buying a product, it is the responsibility of the buyer with its skill, judgment and care and diligence decide that whether whatever the product he is buying is suitable to his requirements or not. And he need to be aware in buying the products rather than depending upon the skill and judgment of the seller. Now, with certain exceptions we have discussed relating to rule of caveat emptor, which included in the case of fitness of the buyer, then in the case of getting the concealment of the fact by fraud, then in the case of sale by sample, sale by description, then in the case of mercantileable quality, in these cases, the rule of caveat emptor would not take into the picture. Now let's discuss what is the relevance of rule of caveat emptor at the present aspect. If we talk about the rule of caveat emptor plays a very important role in the past where trade was conducted on a local. So buyer had ample amount of opportunity to decide that whether the particular product which he or she is buying is examining, he examined the goods and he or she is buying is able to suit his requirements. But now this rule plays a regress role, mitigated. Why? Because now when globalization has taken place, the dimensions of trade have increased, the government legislation of consumer protection, consumer awareness have increases. This rule has particularly mitigated. Take for example, now online shopping has increased a lot. So whenever we are buying certain products through online shopping, whatever description or whatever quality of the products have been explained in the description, we buy according to that. And when we get the product, and suppose I bought a dress from online, description and everything is given and it suited my requirement, I bought the dress. But when I got the delivery of the dress, when I opened the packet, it was torn. So herein, how can I be aware that whether the good which I'm buying online is available to my requirement or not? So here again, seller would be responsible. Why? Because I didn't have that much amount of opportunity to examine the goods while buying at a particular scenario. So that is the point that when we talk about the rule of caveat emptor in the present scenario, it has been mitigated with the global expansion of the trade, with the global expansion of consumer protection and consumer awareness, which increase in the competitions. So with this, students, we have completed your third unit of the contract two with the end of rule of caveat emptor. Any doubt regarding these topics, you can contact me on my mail ID. You can write down my mail ID, which is Sadia, S-A-D-I-A dot Z-E-B at the rate alc.edu.in. You can contact me through mail if any doubt, any clarification on any of the topic you need. Further, I would be forwarding you the notes and PPTs of the concerned topic, which we have discussed in today's lecture. After going through that also, if you have any doubt, you can contact me through the mail ID. I would also be forwarding you an assignment on the same aspect, which would be a case study problem or it can be a question. I request you to read the assignment diligently and submit it on the time. It would be a practice for you before your external exams. Thank you and have a good day.